Namaste, you're on The Nation at 5. I'm Anand Narasimhan and we stay with the development which has shocked the nation. Nobody is able to believe that something like this could unfold. 14 people on board a Mi-17 V-5 chopper, which was on its way from Sulur to the Willingdon Staff College, which had the Chief of Defence Staff, General Bipin Rawat, and his wife, Madhulika Rawat, who's also the President of the DWWA, along with other personnel of his entourage and his security detail, were on board this chopper that crashed sometime between 11 a.m. and 12 p.m. this afternoon. Now we are given to understand that the chances of survival of any of the 14 on board is very, very bleak, although hopes are still up. We don't know the details, but as of now, 13 of the 14 people are feared dead in the crash. Shortly, just a short while ago, we had the update that a female body had also been recovered from the crash site. And with that, it is only everyone fervently hoping that General Bipin Rawat is safe, and he is among the one person who's still surviving. 13 people feared dead already. It looks very, very grim, the news, and we are expecting a briefing from the Raksha Mantri sometime tomorrow, where he would tell Parliament. There is a whole host of developments that we'll bring you up to speed with. But first, going across to our defense editor, Shreya Dhondial, for more details. The nature of the crash, the visuals itself showed and told experts and gave us a hint that the news is not going to be very good. But this is grim, Shreya.
This is grim, and the little hope that everyone was hanging on to in South Block, that's vanishing very fast, Anand. 13 now, people confirmed dead. There were 14 on board, 13 confirmed dead. My sources are telling me there have been more survivors. So this is a tough situation that the country is looking at. But I can tell you the details that we have picked up. The Raksha Mantri continues to be in South Block. The Army Chief has already met him. The Raksha Mantri and the Army Chief both have gone to the CDS's residence. The Air Chief has been flown to the accident site. Both the Chiefs, the Navy Chief and the Army Chief, were out of town. They have rushed back. They have flown back to Delhi as well. Many people are asking why the government is not saying anything officially right now. It's better for the government to come out and put out what has happened rather than for speculation to grow. The fact is that when the Raksha Mantri of the country comes and tells the country what exactly has happened, and this is a tragedy. This is a tragedy unparalleled. He has to be absolutely sure. You have to identify the body. There is a protocol in place. The DNA test is currently underway. Once the identification is done, possibly by late tonight, that is when the Raksha Mantri's statement, I can tell you, is already ready. But once everyone is absolutely sure, once the DNA test results are out, that is when tomorrow the Raksha Mantri on the floor of the House will be making his statement. The CDS's two daughters and their residence, his family there, friends and family have already started arriving. These are, after all, two young girls that we are talking about. Mrs. Madhulika Rawat was traveling with him as well. Reports have now confirmed that one female body has been pulled out from the wreckage. Brigadier Lidder, someone I knew personally, he was on board as well. Lieutenant Colonel Harjinder Singh, again someone I knew personally, was on board as well. Sometimes the professional and the personal do mix, Anand, and this is one of those cases.
Yes, it is. And there are a lot of people who are shocked beyond belief that such a thing could happen. There are a lot of those who had immense respect for General Bipin Rawat. He was very, very matter of fact and said it how he felt it. And it rubbed people the wrong way sometimes, but he just spoke his mind. And that is something which won him a lot of respect. And he had only one task in his hand, that is the security, safety of India and its citizens or Indians. And anything that needed to be done to make India a stronger, safer, better place, more secure place, more secure nation. That was his perhaps single-minded goal and objective. And that was something which commanded immense amount of respect, and we are still hoping against hope that he is safe and he does survive this horrific crash, which now we are given to understand 13 of the 14 people on board are now no more. They are dead, The three people who had been moved to hospital had suffered more than 85% burns. So the condition was serious. But now we're given to understand the hopes are only about this one person. We don't even know the details. We've got Group Captain MJ Vinod with us. Pathikrit Pine is with us. And we also have Major General K.K. Sinha joining us. There are multiple dynamics, dimensions to this to these developments. We're still waiting for an official confirmation. But the Indian Air Force, when it put out the incident, it called it an accident. A Mi-17 chopper, which India bought from the Russians. We had about 139, if I remember correctly, my memory serves me right, of these choppers, which are advanced choppers, which are in mint condition. And when a high-profile person like General Rawat is going to take forward, there will be checks which would be put in place. There is a craft engineer who's also there. I'm just going to check before we go across to our guests this evening and to try and understand from them the impact, the implications of what we are seeing unfold, which has shocked the entire country. I'm just going to check with our team if we have the eyewitnesses' responses. We got a lot of the witnesses speaking in Tamil about what they saw. Let's just listen into what the eyewitnesses had to say. Group Captain MJ Vinod, you also are familiar with Tamil, so you can make of what the various people who we have spoken to, their two or three voices, what their versions actually then put the scenario in front of us.
Plane helicopter apdi vandhuche ore sound karugumunu sound sound vandhona keela ore marathula addu pattu varaliye neruppula vandhuche நெருப்புல வந்தோடனா இங்க ஒரு பெரிய மரம் இருக்கு. அந்த மரத்துல வந்து அடிபட்டோன்னா கீழ அப்படியே தட்டார்னு விழுந்தோடனா புக
நாங்க பர்லியர்ல காலையில குளிச்சுட்டு வெளியில வரும்போது ஹெலிகாப்டர் அப்படியே தாழ்வான நிலைமையில அப்படியே வந்துட்டு இருக்குங்க. மிஸ்ட்னாலயா இனி எதனாலும் தெரியல, ரொம்ப தாழ்வா வந்துட்டு இருக்குது. கிட்டத்தட்ட நம்ம பூமிக்கும் அதுக்கு ஒரு 2000 அடி டிஃப்ரெண்ட், அவ்வளவுதான் இருக்கும். எப்பவுமே ஜாஸ்தி போகும், அன்னைக்கு ரொம்ப கம்மியா இருக்குது. என்ன கம்மியாக இருக்குன்னு வெளியில் வேடிக்கை போட்டிருந்தோம். வேடிக்கை பார்க்கும்போது ஒரு 30 நிமிஷத்தில் ஃபோன் திடீர்னு என்னென்னு பார்த்தீங்கன்னா, அந்த காட்டேரி லாஸ் ஃபால்ஸுக்கு மேலே அரசு தோட்டக்கலை பண்ணை, அங்கே வந்து வண்டி மரத்தில் அடித்து கீழே விழுந்துருக்குங்க. கீழே விழுந்த உடனே தீ பிடிச்சிருக்கு, தீ பிடிச்சிருக்கு. பக்கத்தில் இருந்த வீட்டு இருக்கவங்களும் அதை பார்த்து அலறி அடித்து எல்லாருமே ஓடிருக்காங்க. ஏன்னா யாருமே பக்கத்து போக முடியாது, தீ பிடிச்சினா ஏதாவது வெடிச்சிருமோ நினச்சிட்டு பயந்துட்டு எல்லாருமே ஓடிருக்காங்க. பக்கத்தில் தண்ணி இல்லை, அது கொஞ்சம் நேரத்தில் எல்லாருமே வந்துட்டாங்க. அமைக்கிறக்கு எல்லாருமே ஆஃபீஸருங்க, சம்மந்தப்பட்ட அதிகாரிகள் எல்லாருமே வந்துட்டாங்க.
Group Captain MJ Vinod, you heard their versions. So the second eyewitness says the chopper or the Hepter was flying lower than usually the Hepter's flying is. Was it because of the mist? We don't know. But shortly afterwards, within about 20-25 minutes, we got the report that there's been a crash. The old man, the first eyewitness, he says there was a loud bang because there was a crash. It was a loud bang. We thought this was a transformer burst, but this is what has happened. It's crashed into a tree and then it's gone set into flame. What would you make of something like this? Because helicopters, compared to airplanes, cannot glide. So if the engine stalls, it's a dead drop. You fall down like a stone.
Yeah, and I happened to see these videos earlier as well, because from my Tamilian friend's channel, it came to me on the WhatsApp. The second person spoke a lot of sense. Mm. But let me tell you, as an accident investigator, you normally give not too much of weightage to the eyewitness's account, because eyewitness's account is it's biased, and he has not seen this. It's the first time he's seeing in his life, so his perception could be different. Be that as it may, but the point still remains that they confirmed that there was fog. Mm. They confirmed that visibility was not all that good. They also confirmed that they heard a bang first. Mm. So that is something which we can take cognizance of. Mm. So these are the things that the Court of Inquiry will go into much more detail. But let me also put to rest, Anand. Mm. A lot of theories will come up. A lot of speculations will come up. This happened, that happened, bioweapon, could it be Pakistan, etc., etc. Viewers and it's my humble request to all Indians, don't fall for such propaganda. Mm. It is what it is, and Indian Air Force is going to leave no stone unturned to find out what caused this, and they will go to the bottom of this. And we as Indians will know what caused this. Mm. That is point number one. Point number two is what Anand, you covered. It cannot glide. I mean, aeroplane cannot, helicopter cannot glide. What it does is something called an auto rotation. So when the engine fails, you auto rotate, try to find an open field and land over there. But the third and the most important thing that you covered was that it is a helicopter which is built like a tank. In fact, I was just going to write an article for News 18. CNN News 18, that how this helicopter is built. It is not a normal helicopter. It is a combat helicopter.
Just hold your thoughts, Group Captain Vinod, General Sinha and Patrikrit Pain. We just got news coming through. The Prime Minister is going to chair a Cabinet Committee on Security, CCS meeting this evening at 6:30 p.m. Maria Shakil with the details. Yes, Maria.
Yes, so the Prime Minister will be chairing a crucial meeting. The Cabinet meeting, remember, Anand, is a routine meeting that is held and that was held earlier today. Mm. But the Cabinet Committee on Security, which has top ministers, will be present, will be chaired by the Prime Minister at 6:30 p.m. This, of course, is coming in the backdrop of, General Bipin Rawat's chopper having crashed just a few hours ago. The Raksha Mantri will be briefing the Parliament tomorrow. So the clarity is yet to emerge as to what official nature of briefing will be coming from the government, because in the last 1 hour, we have seen several movements towards his official residence, that is CDS's residence, where Raksha Mantri and also the Chief of Army Staff, that is General M.M. Naravane, have visited the general's home at his official residence. Now, what we are being told is that the Prime Minister will be chairing the crucial meeting, the crucial committee, the Cabinet Committee on Security Affairs will be meeting at 6:30 p.m. Will an announcement related to General Bipin Rawat be coming later or soon after that is something that we'll have to wait and see.
Well, thank you for your inputs. The meeting will happen at 7 locally on Mark, 6:30 p.m. That's what we are given to understand. So whether or not there will be a statement thereafter, we'll have to wait and watch. As of now, the Raksha Mantri Rajnath Singh is not making a statement tonight. That's what we're given to understand. He will address Parliament sometime tomorrow. But will there be more details that would unfold? We will understand. So the nature of the chopper, the Mi-17 V-5, which can carry up to 20 people, it's built like a tank, said Group Captain MJ Vinod before we just moved across to this news that had come in. The timelines also shared, Hondial sharing this, that 8:47 a.m. was the takeoff from Delhi. The manifesto said that there were 9 people who were going to go on board, 7 of his staff, then Mrs. Rawat and also General Rawat. And this plan was to go from Delhi to Sulur, and from Sulur, 2:45 p.m. in the afternoon today was his scheduled lecture at the Staff Training College in Willingdon. Anwit is joining us from right outside General Rawat's residence. What is happening there? A lot of people have come in to meet General Rawat's family. Has anybody made a statement? What is happening there?
If you talk about the visitors, Defense Minister Rajnath Singh himself was here an hour ago, and right now Army Chief is inside the house. You can see right across the road is CDS Bipin Rawat's house, and Army Chief of Army Staff is right now inside the house. He had been meeting the family and the relatives who had come here. It's been almost half an hour. He had come in here around 4:42 is when we were right here, and he had come in here and it's almost been half an hour. He's still inside. He's talking to family members and relatives of Bipin Rawat. Around 10 to 12 relatives have so far come in. We saw them coming in different vehicles, government vehicles as well as in private vehicles. So, and if you talk about the situation on ground, you can see how the number of media contingent has also risen in the past 2 hours. Also, the number of military officials, army officials as well as military police and Delhi police have increased. Now, earlier we were standing right in front of the gate, but now the police have entirely cordoned the area. A barricade has also been put right in front of the gate, which is only removed when a car comes to, and that has to enter the house. So, the entire area has been cordoned. Number of police vehicles and military vehicles have also gone up, because Chief of Army Staff is still inside. He's meeting the family, and when Rajnath Singh had come here, he had also stayed with the family for around 10 minutes, and soon as he left, we were expecting that there will be a statement, official statement on what the condition is, because both Rajnath Singh and Chief of Army Staff have already apprised the family of the latest developments from the hospital where the bodies and those injured have been moved, and also from the ground.
Well, thank you for your inputs, Anwit. Let's try and just understand, reconstruct for our viewers what actually happened. This is as per the Indian Air Force itself. 8:47 a.m. was the takeoff from Delhi. 11:34, the chopper landed at Sulur. Now, soon after, the departure from Sulur happened towards the Staff College in Willingdon. This was around 11:48 p.m. And somewhere around 12:22 is the news of the missing report that was filed. So this is from Sulur to this area. Now, as it was approaching that area, on board were General Bipin Rawat, his wife Madhulika Rawat, and about seven other personnel, including his special officer on detail, his direct assistant, and of course, the personal security detail, which included five soldiers, the Lance Nayaks, and also a Hawaldar. So this was General Bipin Rawat, along with his wife, who were on board. His wife was also going on an official capacity because she's the president of the DWWA. Thereafter, what happens is five minutes before landing is when this entire incident has happened. The chopper was just minutes away from landing. The place where the accident happened is a village which is called the Kateri village. And the Kateri village is just about a 15 to 20 minute drive by road to the Staff College, Willingdon. 5 minutes by chopper maximum. That's what it would have taken, is what locals are saying. And the villagers were the first to respond to this to the crash. The villagers were the first respondents. And despite a drizzle and a fog, they needed to get pots and pots of water and also drag a hose up to try and pull down and put out the fire. So the first response from the eyewitnesses was that the villagers ran from there. They fled because they feared an explosion. Then when they saw that it was burning, then they tried to douse the flames and douse the fire. That's what. Now, there has been an inquiry that has been ordered by the Indian Air Force into this entire accident. That's what they've called it. At a very senior level, there will be an inquiry. And now we are given to understand it's a tri-services inquiry, which will now be conducted to get to the bottom of what actually happened. Let's go across to our guests now. As we put out the timeline, 8:47 a.m. is the exact time of departure. 11:34 a.m. is the time of landing in Sulur. Took off at 11:48 from Sulur again in a chopper. And 12:22 is the missing report. Major General K.K. Sinha, indeed an unfortunate turn of events. And Group Captain M.J. Vinod was saying that the Mi-17 is built like a tank. So, and choppers are thus. The engine is off and it's a dead drop. You don't have the opportunity to glide. Now, if it has caught fire like this, many experts believe it would have had enough fuel to go back, to make the flight back. And if there was a crash landing attempt, then it won't catch fire like this. So, your thoughts on this development. And the other aspect, 13 of the 14 were unable to survive. It looks very, very grim. The news is not very encouraging. And to lose some of these personnel to a freak accident like that, prayers hoping absolutely for the not survival of General Rawat, but this is something which is going to have an impact on our entire defense approach and strategy too, because as the CDS, the first CDS, he was also championing a lot of revolutionary movements within the armed forces. General Sinha.
Nelson, very, very sad news. A personal loss of mine and, of course, a professional loss of a colleague. First thing, you know, because we are from the same squadron from National Defense Academy, and then we have done the National Defense College as a brigadier together, and he has taken over, you know, a operational MGGS operation for me. So very, very close, an incident like this is a personal loss. But I pray, because still one hope is there that, you know, he's a 14th person and he survives. Now, the point coming, you know, the very important thing which you brought it in the end, he's spearheading a revolutionary, you know, we say revolutionary in military affairs. You know, this type of things which takes place once in a lifetime. And it was happening after the Kargil War. You know, theaterization, jointness, things like that. And when the Prime Minister announced the formation of CDS, he didn't announce the name. And subsequently, when he came and he was spearheading, just because of his professional, you know, approach, absolutely upright man, a man with vision, and the way that things were moving, it is a great setback. I was told that there is a cabinet committee of security meeting.
Yes.
Means the things are very, very serious. It has been taken and very rightly so. Any speculations will be wrong at this stage. Only I will try to give it to you because Defence Services Staff College, I have been 4 years, 3 years as a directing staff where he was going, you know, for the presentation to, and this is a routine matter. And 1 year I have done the course. So I know this, and you brought it out that probably 1 minute before the landing it has taken place. So I will try to just comment on that a little bit. And before that, Mi-17, V-5, you know, we have been number of operations with this. We have done a lot of slithering from this. We have done a lot of operations and logistic things, which is in the very, very difficult terrain. Now, coming to Wellington, it is the Nilgiri's Hills.
Yeah.
And where it has happened, it is, I believe it is just 8 kilometers. And the village, you are, we know, next to that is the tea garden. And there are a lot of pine, you know, trees over there. So, you know, and it has a twin engine. And it is a relatively a new VVIP, you know, flight, which has, you know, 17V5 is comparatively a new machine. Which has been there, I was told, which I have gathered from the various news. So, you know, and twin engine. So any speculations, I will not do it at this stage. I leave it, you know, a tri-service inquiry has been ordered. So because Staff College itself is a tri-service organization.
Yeah.
And for your viewers, I would like to, you know, just bring it out. We should wait for a time. But what is the, you know, the terrain? What is the, you know, conditions, this approach to the helipad, which we have done number of, you know, sorties of, you know, landed over there in the helicopters. It is a narrow approach when you come from, especially from Salut, and last minute 8 kilometers. So, and the weather was not, I believe, that much bad because, you know, they fly and they're very experienced and able, you know, pilots are there. And when we're taking a VVIP, I'm very sure. So let's wait what went wrong. It is very unfortunate that we have lost, and we have got a great nation has got a loss.
Yeah.
So what you have brought it out is absolutely correct. You know, a very, very tragic, you know, things which should not happen. I leave it for the official confirmation and why it happened. No right. speculations. And it is a great loss.
Because such was the nature of the flame or the fire, it was so strong that most of the bodies are charred beyond recognition. That's what we're given to understand. And that's why there is a DNA effort testing which is going on to confirm the identities of everybody. Last week, was one of the charred bodies recovered was of a female. So there's only one female on board, and that was Mrs. Rawat. So the conclusions are once again very, very unfortunate turn of events and grim. The news is not very good. Let's go across to Arunima for an update. Arunima, CCS meeting at 6:30. What's the agenda? Do we know? And is there an expectation of an official confirmation of the turn of events and the details of the dead by this evening?
And I can't hear you very well. Can you repeat your question, please?
If you can hear me, CCS meeting is scheduled at 6:30. What is on the agenda? And are we expecting an announcement over what happened this morning and those who could not survive?
Yes, so that CCS which has been called in, there was cabinet earlier today. Usually when CCS meetings happen, which is the Cabinet Committee on Security, they happen along the same time as the cabinet. Once the cabinet gets over, then the Prime Minister, the Defence Minister, the Home Minister, the Finance Minister, the External Affairs Minister, they sit together and finish the deliberation. But in this case, this is a special CCS meet which has been called, which is, I think, one more indicator of how grim the news could be from Tamil Nadu. We have not been officially told. CCS agendas are usually not made public. But given the circumstances that have developed today since afternoon, one can understand why the CCS is being called. And like I said, that is one more indicator of the grim news that is coming in from Tamil Nadu. Will we hear anything officially? I don't think so. But the protocol, what we are talking about is the first CDS of the country. And the news from South Block, the news from the district administration at Ground Zero is extremely grim. So you could see some finalization of the protocol that has to be followed once that grim news that we are all dreading is confirmed. The three service chiefs, out of them, the air chief is there at Ground Zero. But the army and the navy chief have also returned to the city. They were all both outside for giving a lecture as well. They have returned to the city. So I think those protocols will be finalized, and Raksha Mantri will make it official tomorrow when he speaks in Parliament.
True. Thank you for your inputs. Going across to Pathikrit Payne, I keep going back to what the eyewitnesses said. The eyewitness, one of them says that it was flying lower than usual, not more than about 2,500 feet above ground, which is surprising. They said, could it be because of the mist? That's one aspect. The other thing is that it just dropped. It dropped, it crashed into the tree and caught fire.
Anand, generally when somebody of the stature of the CDS flies, or somebody of that stature, whether it's the chief of army staff or anybody, the pilots generally would be somebody of the rank of a wing commander and assisted by a squadron leader ranked pilot. So far as the capability of the pilots, so far as the protocols that are to be followed before a helicopter would fly in such a scenario is concerned, I'm sure everything was followed to the last minute details. But, in those terrains, some of my sources are saying that during the noon time, weather is extremely unpredictable. So sometimes even when you have the right kind of, weather forecasting with which you actually start flying, eventually in between, the weather might have some kind of a change. And in any case, you see over the last, say, 1 month, overall in South India, and especially in Tamil Nadu, the weathers have been fluctuating. There has been a lot of rains in any case happening. Secondly, yes, the kind of inferno that we actually saw, and especially I saw it on your channel, generally it seemed that the helicopter was prepared for a return flight as well, which means it was carrying a considerable amount of fuel. So when any kind of a helicopter carries that kind of fuel, the possibility of an inferno actually goes up very significantly. But third, and it's very important to understand, and the first speaker from the honorary speaker from the Air Force who mentioned it, that helicopters are, the exit from a helicopter in case of an eventuality is very, very challenging. And it cannot glide. There is no exit route. The rotor blades actually sometimes can cut through the helicopter itself. So the fatality aspect is always profound. And in any case, Anand, every time you go up the sky, there is a certain level of risk with which you actually go. But we have to also understand that MI-17 V-5, these were 139 of them were taken probably around a decade back during UPA era. These are state-of-the-art aircraft in the medium range category, medium lift transport helicopter category, in the 12-ton category. They have night flying capabilities. They have very good avionics, their ability to even hard land is very good. So it's not that, I'm sure the best of efforts might have been made. But yes, sometimes when an accident happens. Even when everything is taken care of, something can just go wrong and where, you just can't do anything. But I just want to again mention what you mentioned and what General Sinha also talked about. He was one of the finest. In any case, the armed forces have a very good, ability to create leadership. But General Rawat, the kind of reforms that he was bringing in, and his ability to actually push through the concerns of the armed forces against bureaucratic resistance, and I must mention it, was profound. If over the last few years, the manner in which this government has been acquiring critical weapon systems, I'm sure the recommendations, the inputs of General Rawat, first as Chief of Army Staff and later as a Chief of Defense Staff, to give the holistic picture, had played a very, very critical role. And that cannot be, ignored or underestimated at all. Second, right, the kind of reforms that he was bringing in, theaterization, as was already mentioned, especially when that kind of theater command has already been made by China. Secondly, developing the integrated battle groups, the cadre review of the Indian Army, which has been pending for a long time. He was moving through those things at a breakneck speed, and he was reformist. He had a vision. You know, we still hope that somehow, you know, a miracle happens and, you know, he survives. But let me tell you, when the government takes this kind of time, there are standard operating procedures again in place. Protocols have to be followed. Every minute statement that is made or in the, during the declaration by the government in the formal, you know,
yes,
speech, everything has to be to the last minute. I'm sure there is a logbook to follow for that. In any case, the armed forces are on high
they,
alert.
There they want to be. They want to be absolutely sure, 100% sure. And although the signs are very grim and it points to was, we would still want to say he is, and that's how optimistic we would want to be as far as General Rawat is concerned. But Group Captain MJ Vinod, before I play out the eyewitnesses again, if we see the way events are unfolding, we have the Raksha Mantri, the Army Chief calling on at General Rawat's residence. It's not General Rawat's family which is making air, which is being air dashed to Sulur or towards Kunur or to Uti for to be with the family or to be with him. So these are all indications that the news is grim. The developments and the detail of and the information of a female body being recovered points to Mrs. Rawat. We'll wait for the official confirmation. 13 of the 14 already declared dead. There are so the chances of a survivor very, very bleak. But it's still there. So the hope against hope remains. And what the eyewitnesses are now saying points to some of the possibilities which will now become the object of speculation. We will desist from that. But what we would like to tell you is that this happened between 11:45 and 12:15. So it was midday. It was not early morning. It was midday around the time this incident has actually happened. Was there very, very inclement weather? Locals say no. There was a bit of a mist. There was a slight drizzle, but it was not bad. And there was a decision that was taken that the chopper will take off and the chopper will fly. So that means the flying conditions had been assessed and they were not high risk. So let's listen into what the witnesses have to say.
கருகுமுன்னு சவுண்டு சவுண்டு வந்தவுடனே கீழே ஒரு மரத்தில் அடிபட்டு வரையிலேயே நெருப்பில் வந்துச்சு. நெருப்பில் வந்தவுடனே இங்கே ஒரு பெரிய மரம் இருக்குது, அந்த மரத்தில் வந்து அடிபட்டோன்னே கீழே அப்படியே தட்டார்னு விழுந்தோன்னா புகை.
நாங்கள் பர்லியரில் காலையில் குளிச்சுட்டு வெளியில் வரும்போது ஹெலிகாப்டர் அப்படியே தாழ்வான நிலைமையில் அப்படியே வந்துட்டுருக்குங்க. மிஸ்ட்னாலையா இனி எதனாலன்னு தெரில, ரொம்ப தாழ்வாக வந்துட்டுருக்குது. கிட்டத்தட்ட நம்ம பூமிக்கும் அதுக்கு ஒரு 2000 அடி டிஃப்ரெண்ட், அவ்வளோதான் இருக்கும். எப்பவுமே ஜாஸ்தி போகும், அன்றைக்கி ரொம்ப கம்மியாக இருக்குது. இன்னும் கம்மியாக இருக்குன்னு வெளியிலும் வேடிக்கை போட்டிருந்தோம். வேடிக்கை பார்க்கும்போது ஒரு 30 நிமிஷத்தில் ஃபோன் திடீர்னு என்னென்னு பார்த்தீங்கன்னா, அந்த காட்டேரி லாஸ் ஃபால்ஸுக்கு மேலே அரசு தோட்டக்கலை பண்ணை அங்கே வந்து வண்டி மரத்தில் அடித்து கீழே விழுந்துருக்குங்க. கீழே விழுந்த உடனே தீ பிடிச்சிருக்கு, தீ பிடிச்சிருக்கு. பக்கத்தில் இருந்த வீட்டு இருக்கவங்களும் அதை பார்த்து அலறி அடித்து எல்லாருமே ஓடிருக்காங்க. ஏன்னா யாருமே பக்கத்து போக முடியாது, தீ பிடிச்சினா ஏதாவது வெடிச்சிருமான்னு நினச்சிட்டு பயந்துட்டு எல்லாருமே ஓடிருக்காங்க. பக்கத்தில் தண்ணி இல்லை, அது கொஞ்சம் நேரத்தில் எல்லாருமே வந்துட்டாங்க. அமைக்கிறக்கு எல்லாருமே ஆஃபீஸருங்க சம்மந்தப்பட்ட அதிகாரிகள் எல்லாருமே வந்துட்டாங்க.
So this is the entire turn of events, the developments, each of these visuals. Some of the visuals very disturbing, ladies and gentlemen. We are exercising restraint over playing those visuals because it does show that there were charred bodies. Some other eyewitness accounts also give quite disturbing details of what they saw and the kind of inferno that was visible at that point. But General Sinha, to fly at an altitude which is very, very low, and they say it banged into a tree, then crashed and banged again and crashed into more trees and then was up in flames. These are visuals of Stalin, the Tamil Nadu chief minister, en route towards Uti. He said that he is going to make his way up to Coimbatore and then also try and head towards the crash site this evening itself. So these are visuals of him on his way. He should be arriving at the crash site very soon. He had himself, his office itself had confirmed that towards the evening he would set forth from Chennai towards Coimbatore, and from Coimbatore he would make his way towards this region, this area which is Kunur and the Kateri village area where the crash has happened. So these are visuals of him getting up to the airport and from where he will then make his way. It's late evening now, early evening now, and we should see Stalin reach the crash site sometime soon after sundown, around 6:30 p.m. or 7 p.m. That's when he will be present. So the Tamil Nadu chief minister on his way to Konur. So from Chennai, the word was that he would move from Chennai towards Coimbatore and from Coimbatore then head towards Ooty. Purnima now joining us with more details. Purnima, what's his schedule and what time is he likely to arrive towards near the crash site? Purnima, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Purnima, what is Chief Minister Stalin's plan?
Well, Chief Minister is taking the added flights to Coimbatore. From then, he will be going to the crash site via road. And N.K. Stalin had earlier spoken to the police chief as well as the collector, asking them to ensure that they accelerate the pace of treatment for those people who have been rescued. And he has been in touch with the local authorities in Coimbatore district to ensure that he gets updates of the happenings, and also to ensure that the special teams from Coimbatore have been sent to the Ooty government hospital for further treatment. Therefore, N.K. Stalin will be leaving from Chennai and will be reaching Coimbatore, and then will visit Kunnur via road. That's the plan of N.K. Stalin.
By what time is he likely to reach Kunnur?
Well, it will take about 1.5 hours for N.K. Stalin to reach Kunnur. That's the plan. And they, along with him, senior bureaucrats will also be traveling. That's the update from the Tamil Nadu government here, that along with N.K. Stalin, senior officials will also be traveling. And in about 2 hours from now, we could perhaps expect Stalin to reach Kunnur from Coimbatore via road.
Well, it will be late evening, quite after dark there by the time. So is he going to stay overnight, wait until tomorrow morning? Or is he scheduled to go, even though it's going to be dark, is he scheduled to go to the crash site and talk to the locals and to the officials there?
Well, at the moment, his team says that he will be visiting the crash site, provided it isn't dark. But he will anyway check with the local authorities in terms of whether he has to stay there tonight till tomorrow, or whether he can return tonight itself. At the moment, he will be visiting. He will be taking the chartered flight to Coimbatore, and from there will be reaching the crash site, is what his team is telling us at this point in time. And in terms of what he plans to do, whether he plans to stay there, depends on what really happens and what he hears from the local authorities there. At the moment, there is no return plan yet. And all the depending on the developments there, depending on the reports that he gets from the district administration there, he will plan his return. But at the moment, no return plans as of now.
Well, thank you for your inputs, Purnima. Going back to Group Captain M.J. Vinod and also Major General K.K. Sinha, and Patikrit Payan. Group Captain M.J. Vinod is also an accident investigator. General K.K. Sinha has not only studied at that staff training college in Willingdon, he's also been a director there. So let me ask the two gentlemen. General Sinha was talking about the approach, saying it's a narrow approach, but it's not something which is going to be so hazardous. The other aspect is, from the eyewitness and also the time of the day, it is midday. So it's not that daylight would be a peril. And these flights or these sorties would not be undertaken if there was a flight risk. Will the communication be critical? What was said before the incident happened? What was the final communication that came from the cockpit to the base? How critical will that be? Because the witnesses say we don't know whether it was missed or not, but it was unusual for the chopper to fly so low.
Yeah, that is absolutely true. See, those locals over there have seen this helicopter operating. And let me tell you, Anand, for the benefit of our viewers, let me tell you this. Before we carry a PVIP to any new helipad, even if you have operated in the helipad, you do a trial run. And I am more than sure the trial run may have been carried out when before bringing in General Rawat. And the same crew carries out this trial run. So these people would have seen this trial landing being happening yesterday, day before, or probably even today morning itself. So that is one. So their memory is very, very, what do you call that, very, very current, that the helicopter previously went up slightly above, now went slightly below. The question that you asked, and I was just remarking, and it's a valid question. Is it a CFIT? CFIT means controlled flight into the terrain. That's a valid question that only the court of inquiry can answer. And very wonderful tool that court of inquiry has today is the flight data recorder.
Yeah.
So this flight data recorder will be able to tell us how low they were, what kind of impact that happened, what is the G forces that got generated, all the eyewitness information. And I'm sticking my neck out to say this, like you said, an accident investigator, and I also done the staff college there, and I have a small piece of land over there. So I'm more like a local there. I'll stick out my neck out and say that we need to take cognizance of what the locals are saying. And the question that you asked, whether it is a CFIT. So the word CFIT, the word bad weather, the word they were flying low, the word something called microburst, will also come into play as we go along in a couple of days to come.
Right.
Maybe about microbursts.
We've just got an update where sources have told the news agency ANI, and I'm quoting them, that Wing Commander Prithvi Singh Chauhan, he was the pilot of the Mi-17V5, which crashed with 14 personnel on board, including the CDS General Bipin Rawat. He's the commanding officer of the 109 helicopter. So it was very, very experienced personnel who were on board and who were also responsible for the CDS. Clearly, a high-profile entity like him, you would have the best among, and who would take the owner's responsibility and perform the duty, undertake the duty. But General K.K. Sinha, you've also taken off, landed from that region. Midday, is it inclement? Is it something which is going to be testing or trying? And is there constant communication which happens between the pilot and the base on the flight arrival? And if it is just 5 minutes before landing, of course, base would have been aware and been on standby.
Anand, you know, I'm taking advantage of my experience over there. First thing, you know, what I can make it out and see, there is no problem as far as the helipad is concerned. It is a huge area, huge. And because it is a golf course, the part of the golf course, it's an extension of that where the helipads are there, huge area. Approach or when he sits down, when you say that, you know, it was flying low and so it was not in a, you know, this is called when a helicopter sits down, it's getting a hovering mode. So it is not a hovering mode. The approach is only from two sides, you know, if I can, you know, give it, because I don't want to give it, you know, because on the other side, there's a hill. And this side is has got buildings and everything. The staff college is just, if you walk from there, the itself is just 5 to 6 minutes.
Right.
So it is not difficult. These are routine matters on which, you know, generally the VIP comes. And it is a routine because there are 40 to 50% of, you know, is generally, you know, very, very experienced officers coming and speaking to these officers who are under training for a year. And it's a tri-service. A lot of VIP comes, including civilians. So that is not a problem. And I was told that he was a group captain, you know, Chauhan name, which you said. He was a group captain and probably he may be the, you know, OC or the CEO of that unit. He was flying himself and there was a squad leader. So the pilots are experienced. What happened? No speculations. We have to wait for, you know, and things will come out. As group captain was saying that probably there is a, you know, we have got that box. Moment, you know, the box is recovered, you will come to know. There will be some, you know, thing will must be available because I was told that it was just 8 kilometers, meant 2 to 3 minutes of, you know, sitting down of the helicopter.
Correct.
Twin engine Mi-17V5, a powerful, this thing. So things, let's see, no speculations. I'm just bringing out the characteristics of that and a little bit knowledge of that area. Because we have spent a lot of time over there on those fields and the golf courses where there is a, you know, helipads are there. So let's see. And we should not rule out anything whatsoever. a CCS meeting as the app thing which is happening.
Right.
And yeah. I'm not pointing out or bringing out every, you should take every
well the silence reason. Or the silence or the restraint from the establishment is also now setting off another fresh round of politics with Shiv Sena MP Priyanka Chaturvedi. Now she has questioned the silence on General Rawat. She has tweeted saying, why is India not being given an update by the government on our Chief of Defence Staff? And why is it allowing whisper and rumour mongering unabated? Is a question that's being asked. They're saying, whatever it is, good, bad or ugly, we need an update. Whatever the update, good, bad, ugly, Indians need to know. That's what she has tweeted. That's what she has come out and said. Vinaya Deshpande now joining us with more. Vinaya, so now Shiv Sena jumps into it. Priyanka Chaturvedi saying, why are you quiet? Why don't you tell us? Why don't you give us an update?
Well, yes, now this seems to be turning political, Anand, because, you know, we learned that it is likely that tomorrow the Raksha Mantri will give a statement in front of the House. And now there's a question that is being raised by Shiv Sena MP Priyanka Chaturvedi asking why the government isn't coming clean with respect to what is the exact status about the CDS. Remember, there has been widespread concern with respect to the safety of the CDS, his family, his wife, as well as the other senior officials who were present on board that chopper. So right now, Shiv Sena jumping into it, asking why is it that the government is mum despite it being so many hours after the incident, and whatever it is, the government should come out with a clear statement giving out details about what exactly has happened, because the country needs to know.
Well, thank you for your inputs. There's a story on news18.com, please do read it, where General Bipin Rawat's brother-in-law has also now been asked to reach Delhi, and he says, I just spoke to them last evening, and he said, I was told that they had to attend a special program. The nature of the program was not divulged, because he says that for security reasons, they tell me only after it is over and then they are back. And quite shocked that this has happened. The person we used to be in, so then they have also, there has been some more details that have been divulged. They're saying the person who we used to be directly in touch with has passed away in the same accident, is what he has said on the unfortunate development. So this is the information. News18.com has plenty of stories and details related to the entire incident. Let's try and reconstruct what actually happened. 8:47 a.m. is when this flight with 9 people took off from Delhi to Sulur and landed around 11:34. Soon after, around 11:47, it has already taken off from Sulur, that's bottom here in Tamil Nadu, and then gone up towards the borders of Tamil Nadu with Karnataka and Kerala. That is the entire hilly area, and Coimbatore lies there, and near Coimbatore is the Kunur area, the Nilgiri Hills and the Kunur region. And this is where is the Staff College Willingdon, just about 5 minutes from there. On board this chopper were General Bipin Rawat and Mrs. Rawat, both going in official capacity. Mrs. Rawat as the president of the DWWA and General Rawat as the CDS, Chief of Defence Staff, going there to give a lecture, deliver a lecture scheduled at 2:45 p.m. What happens thereafter is just minutes before landing. They say 2 to 3 minutes or maximum 5 minutes before landing. This incident takes place. So the aircraft the Hepta, as eyewitnesses say, was flying lower than usual. And this is where the incident happens. And the incident happens near the Kateri village. The Kateri village is exactly about 8 kilometers, 8 to 9 kilometers from the Staff College Willingdon. So maximum a 15 minute drive by road and 2 to 3 minutes flight time and then descent. So 5 minutes max is what many would say from this spot where it happened. The first to reach the spot were villagers who first fled the scene after the bang and the flames, then came back when they're fearing an explosion. They ran away, but then came back to see if they can save people. They had to use pots and also their local hoses to try and douse the flames. It was a blazing inferno that they all encountered. And now a tri-services inquiry has been ordered. So it started with the IAF announcing an inquiry, but now it's a tri-services inquiry into the entire incident, into the accident, to understand what actually happened, that 14 people now, the fate of 14 people now hangs in the balance. One of them, still we are given to understand, is the survivor. 13 are feared dead, including Mrs. Rawat, because a female body has been recovered from the debris. But we are hoping that the one person who's still a survivor is General Bipin Rawat. Although the news and the updates coming from ground are very, very grim, and the developments very bleak. But we can only hope against hope. So this is the entire trail of events via visuals. The IAF chopper crashing. 13 bodies have been recovered out of 14 people on board. Minutes after the crash, this was visuals. There was a blazing inferno because there was a lot of fuel in the chopper, and it caught fire. So experts say if it's caught fire, it's dropped like a stone, and that's when the fire happens, because if it's attempted a crash landing, it wouldn't have been blazing like this. Rescue ops are still on play. Teams are on the ground, locals coming on to rescue. Like I said, they've drawn a hose pipe from one of the homes nearby and to try and put out the fire, douse the flames. That's the extent to which they have tried to work there, and the teams are on ground. Group Captain MJ Vinod, have you been able to wrap your head around these developments and to try and figure out what exactly could have happened? Would you hazard a guess or speculation as to what could happen? An experienced wing commander in Prithvi Singh Chauhan at the helm, flying that Mi-17 chopper. Mi-17s, are they stable units themselves?
See, as I was telling you earlier, this Mi-17 is built like a tank. In fact, if you look at the Mi-17 V5, the frontal portion of the Mi-17 V5, you will see two sword-like structure and up and down. I mean, you can pull out the image while I'm talking about it. Those are called wire cutters, Anand. Those wire cutters are designed to cut the wire when these helicopters fly low, and by mistake, they go into high-tension wires. So the wire cutter is on the bulkhead, which is the strongest portion of the helicopter. This helicopter is also built for not to catch fire, which means the fuel tank is a special fuel tank. So it is not a civilian helicopter. It is a combat helicopter. The seats are designed in a manner that it can take a high amount of shock. The straps are designed in a manner that it can take a very high amount of shock. And mind you, the tail rotor and the main rotor, they are not a normal civilian helicopter rotor. They are designed to take bullets and still survive. So that is the kind of design that goes behind. In fact, a lot of it you will hear from me later. That is the kind of design aspect that goes into making.
My limited knowledge tells me this chopper is equipped to even take a certain level, bear the brunt of a crash landing, and to secure the passengers. So in this case, eyewitnesses are also saying it just dropped like a rock and it crashed into a tree and dropped. So how would it crash into a tree if it was not under control? So that is also another question that remains. So we'll see what the inquiry says. But as of now, the news is very bleak. Shreya Dhondiala, defense editor, tracking the developments very closely. Once again, the updates not very encouraging. Uttarakhand Chief Minister Pushkar Dhami is also now heading towards the village of CDS General Rawat.
Correct. He comes from Pauri Gharhwal. This is where General Rawat's ancestral villages. And even as CDS, he's made multiple trips to his village. The latest coming in is that the chief minister of the state, that is Pushkar Singh Dhami, is on his way because, relatives there are worried. There is no certain news that has come out. All the news that has come out has been largely depressing. Things are not looking very good. Most aviation experts on your show have also pointed out that if you look at the pictures that have come out from the crash site, anyone surviving the crash will be a miracle. So there are obviously worries and questions. And the fact that two service chiefs have been called back to Delhi, one service chief has been sent
to the crash site, the fact that the Chief Minister is making that trip to CDS General Bipin Rawat's residence, the fact that the Raksha Mantri continues to be in South Block, the fact that at 6:30 there is a CCS that will be held, all these point to a direction which is not looking very good.
Yes, and the indications are also that the family members, the near and dear, next of kin, are not being rushed to the spot or to the hospital. There are many who are trying to call upon the near and dear, and they're all making a move towards the ancestral village, etc. That itself is not a very encouraging indication, Shreya.
It isn't at all. In fact, General Rawat's two daughters are at his residence, which is barely 5 to 6 minutes away from where I am right now, which is in South Block. The Raksha Mantri has already met them. Mm. The Army Chief has already gone and met them. These are young girls, after all. Yes, his extended family is there with them as well. So, ever since the news came in, you've had friends and family come to the house because no one's certain about what has happened, but whatever arrangements now need to be made, the family will need to be consulted, and the family has been consulted. A final confirmation, the statement from the government of India, that will come maybe only tomorrow, but we are being told, Anand, that by tonight there'll be some amount of confirmation that will come in. The DNA test currently underway.
Well, the opposition is also asking, the Shiv Sena has raised this question, why the silence? Why can't you give us an update? The government is saying we've got to follow protocol, we've got to get it absolutely right. But the indications are the family is not being rushed to Kunur. The next of kin and the nearer dear are being asked to come to the capital. So the indications very grim of the turnout or the outcome of what happened earlier in the day. Shocking turn of events. Everybody is still trying to come to grips with what has happened. And it's the safety, the well-being of General Bipin Rawat, the Chief of Defence Staff, and his wife, Madhulika Rawat, along with his entire entourage, members of the Indian Armed Forces. Stay with us.